Ah, school. Reading, writing, and arithmetic. Little Johnny just has to do 10 math problems and it's recess time. Should be pretty easy. He just needs to remember those times tables. 3 times 3 is... Well, and now he's thinking about that TikTok he saw this morning where the cat fell over. That was a classic. Might as well pull out the phone and watch it again. Wait, what's the teacher yelling about? Brain rot. They're the words on everyone's minds. And if you ask teachers, it's a very real problem with kids' attention spans and critical thinking. But is it really happening? And is it affecting far more than just kids? Find out on this episode of The Infographic Show. Science proves if brain rot is really making you dumb. So, what is brain rot anyway? It's not like it's a new concept. We all grew up with our parents yelling, "That music is garbage!" Or, "Those cartoons are gonna rot your brain!" And everyone knows nothing ever came of the Beatles or the Simpsons, so it's not like the old folks don't ever miss once in a while. But this era, it seems different. People aren't just convinced the current media is bad. They're worried that it's actually damaging the cognitive abilities of a whole generation, and they might have science to prove it. And when something gets named Word of the Year, people tend to pay attention. Oxford University named brain rot as its Word of the Year in 2024, and it gave us a credible definition to go with it. The deterioration of a person's mental or intellectual state, often caused by overconsumption of low-quality online content. It can also refer to the content itself, but the term goes back much further than that. The first recorded use of the term was actually by philosopher Henry David Thoreau in 1854, when he described a decline in intellectual standards. This was one of many things he was seeking to escape at Walden Pond. But today it's harder and harder to escape. Low-quality, thinking-free content was always around. Your grandfather likely grew up watching Mo poke Curly in the eyes, and he may have gotten a whooping for trying to duplicate it on his brother. Gen X kids probably enjoyed watching ridiculous wrestling matches in the 1980s, and the millennials had their early viral videos on the internet. Remember Neon Cat? That rainbow-pooping Pop-Tart cat sure could cruise around the cosmos. But something is different now. How did this become a global problem? Well, it all comes down to one word: algorithm. In the past, people engaged with content when it was available, often on live TV. You watched 20 minutes of cartoons or an hour of wrestling, and then you did something else and your brain recalibrated. Even with those early viral videos, there was usually nothing to keep you tethered to the internet. Today, most streaming entertainment is delivered by social media companies that keep tabs on your data. That means they know what you're watching, and they're ready to give you more of it. If you like one song, you can repeat it ad nauseum or just move on to the next one with only a click. And that means it's easy to spend the day scrolling away. These sites are designed to be addictive, and X, Facebook, and Reddit all use a front page style that just lets you roll the page down and deliver new posts indefinitely. Similarly, YouTube will always have a new video ready for you when you finish the old one. And if you have autoplay on, well, you don't even need to click to start watching it. That means if you wanted, you could just mainline infographic show videos all day. But there are plenty of other video sources out there that won't provide nearly that much information. And all those channels start getting their fans very early. If you asked the average parent to define brain rot, they would probably say, "That annoying song my kid keeps playing." A common complaint is that YouTube has been taken over by low-effort content forms designed to create simple but catchy songs that kids will become obsessed with and play endlessly. Many of these tunes are either based on public domain songs, like the wildly popular toddler TV show Cocomelon. Others are a lawyer's nightmare, engaging in frequent copyright infringement. Ever wanted to see the Inside Out Emotions dance to BTS songs? You're in luck. And there's a new culprit in this: the robots. Everyone's been talking about AI, and while the technology isn't perfect, many content creators are finding it useful to automate certain parts of the process. However, attempts to use it to create all content without a human touch have usually fallen very flat, except for the content farms, which really don't care about a high level of quality. They just care that toddlers won't be able to tell the difference, and most of them don't. That makes it easier to pump out those videos faster and faster, keeping kids hooked. And to say the impact has been significant would be putting it lightly. The frontline soldiers when it comes to discovering the impact of brain rot have been teachers. Gen Z and now Gen Alpha are digital natives, with many of them growing up with a smartphone in their hands. In some cases, that means they've been mainlining content in their eyeballs since they were toddlers, and that has an impact on attention span. For older kids and adults, they might have very different memories, such as being read a leisurely story by mom and then sitting through long and detailed lessons in school. But now everything seems sped up. A key element of brain rot is that it is fast. Most content today aimed at kids is under a minute, with many of the popular YouTube videos being even shorter. The iconic Skibidi Toilet, one of the most famous examples of brain rot, starts with only about 20 seconds of singing heads sticking out of toilets, and later installments rarely cross the 2-minute mark. And then there's TikTok, if it's still running. The quick viral video app is full of influencers who have mastered the art of explaining their content in under a minute, whether it's accurate or not. And that impact is seen in the classroom every day. Current studies show that the average attention span of Gen Z has declined a lot. In 2004, it was 2.5 minutes. By 2012, it had declined to 75 seconds. And in 2018, it was only 47 seconds. But not only that, but the first decline in attention begins after only 8 seconds. That's led many teachers to say they feel like they have to perform for their students, not just teach them. They're tailoring their lessons to keep their attention without focusing too long on one topic. For some teachers, that's easier, but it's incredibly challenging when you're trying to help them master an in-depth topic like the infamous long division. So, we know the kids aren't all right, but is it just the kids? Millennials and even older generations might not have grown up with a smartphone in our hands, but we have certainly got one now. The call of social media is impossible to avoid, and today most people find themselves casually using their phone almost constantly. Commutes used to be filled with people reading newspapers. Now almost everyone is on their phones, and they can even make it easy to pass the time while standing in line at the DMV. If someone has earbuds, they can watch videos. And if not, there are still plenty of amusing memes to scroll through. And it might just be undoing decades of progress. Even adults have found themselves struggling with attention span at work, and when they read for leisure, finding it incredibly easy to get distracted and turn to the smartphone again. A big part of this is the algorithm behind social media is designed to be addictive. After all, what's the harm in one more scroll on Reddit? But there is increasing evidence that it might not just be a psychological element. The change in our memory spans isn't simply due to getting used to social media as part of life. These new changes to how we consume media might actually be changing our biology. At some point in prehistory, a strange-looking land animal decided to move closer to the water to make it easier to hunt fish and crabs. The new food source was welcoming, and over the years, the animal and its descendants spent more and more time in the water. Their bodies started to evolve to it, and after countless cycles, they had evolved into today's whales, animals completely habituated to the water and unable to survive on land. If that story was testing your attention span, you might be in the same situation as the prehistoric animal, with your body and mind evolving to account for the new media paradigm. But those changes may not be to our benefit. In 2019, the World Psychiatry Association published a paper detailing what they called the online brain. It confirmed many of the things people had observed. Heavy social media use was shortening our attention spans and weakening our memory, as well as changing the way we think. But it was doing more than that. In observing the brains of children who grew up with heavy screen time and comparing them to those who had limited access to smartphones, there was a marked difference in the size of gray matter. And almost no one is safe. A study in the UK showed that the average UK adult was spending at least 4 hours a day online, with Gen Z men spending around 5.5 and Gen Z women spending almost 6.5. But even when you filter that out, that means the older generations are spending 3 hours or more on average consuming information from the internet. And that is getting less and less reliable. Major tech companies now flood search results with AI-generated summaries, blurring fact and fiction. Meanwhile, influencers thrive by inserting conspiracy theories into real-time crises, feeding confusion and fear. For someone whose primary source of knowledge is the internet, that could make them very vulnerable to disinformation. So, the question is, what is to be done? For the kids, more and more parents and schools are starting to push back. Multiple states have announced they're introducing or bringing back cell phone bans at school, but that's only half of the battle. Kids who've been raised on them are already addicted and their minds are attuned to this kind of content. That means every day under cell phone bans will likely be a battle for teachers to get them to put them away and pay attention if they can. Generation Beta might have a better chance. More parents are questioning the wisdom of giving kids cell phones or tablets early. If the newest generation has less screen time and is exposed to less brain rot, they might have a better chance when starting school. But what about the rest of us? Well, it turns out Grandma might have had a point. Scientists are just beginning to study the long-term effects of heavy internet and smartphone use on the brain. But some experts are already starting to give tips to those who want to reverse the effects. The best thing they say you can do is put down the phone. Taking a break from content, even a short one, can help your brain recalibrate. Take the time to do a craft, work through a crossword puzzle or a Sudoku puzzle, or if you can't bear to be without screens, turn on Wheel of Fortune and play along. It all keeps the brain more active than aimlessly scrolling. But while the loss of memory and cognition might be one big problem, it's not the only one. Another key factor in how brain rot is making us dumber is what it makes us believe. There is a quote commonly attributed to a legendary American author, Mark Twain: "A lie can travel around the world while the truth is still putting on its shoes." And that has never been clearer than in the internet age. During the 2025 California wildfires, websites like TikTok and X, the former Twitter, were hotbeds of conspiracy theories from every direction. Some claimed that drones were setting the fires, causing a firefighting drone to be damaged. Others claimed that the reason there was no water to fight the fires was because a billionaire pistachio magnate had privatized all the water. More ridiculously, the claim that 8 Ukrainian generals had their houses burned down in the fire went viral, with no one thinking to ask why Ukrainian generals would have houses in the Hollywood Hills. And as ridiculous as all those were, they spread far and wide. It's become increasingly common for the younger generation to rely on TikTok for news, with many quoting it as a primary source when questioned. The result is everything from humorous stories about how to create infinite chocolate to teenagers committing check fraud because of a TikTok promising them one secret trick to free money. But the older generation isn't safe either. Facebook is full of pages spreading fake stories backed up by AI art that's designed to raise high emotions. This was especially common during the North Carolina floods that devastated many communities, with pictures going viral of crying children being evacuated while carrying wet pets, except none of them were real. And this could be creating a scary future. Politics have always been divisive, with everyone having their own opinion. But what happens when everyone has their own facts? Political debates today are usually less about how to solve a problem and more about whether a problem is actually happening. In some cases, it's about how you define it, but in others, one side has an objective truth on its side and the other has very strong emotions based on a fake video they just watched. And this has resulted in many teachers having to repeatedly explain things and many millennials nervously asking their boomer parents exactly where they heard that. But the shocking part is not everyone thinks that there is something wrong with that. We've all heard it from someone with an addiction: "I don't need help, I can quit anytime I want." But that might not be the case for digital natives. Generation Z, or the iPad kids, have been transformed in some unique ways, including the way they talk. They use slang that's baffling to adults, including the infamous skibbity and other terms like riz. But most view this just as a funny quirk that speaks to their generation, and it helps them make sense in a world that increasingly doesn't feel safe. And for some, the brain rot itself is comforting. The majority of brain rot targets are very young kids who are new to the digital world, aiming to hook them quickly. But it's picked up another audience, teenagers, who sometimes just like to turn their brains off. There is a sense of absurdism to many of the things that Gen Z embraces, such as the viral movie Goncharov. You remember Goncharov, right? The 1980s Martin Scorsese movie about the Russian mob? No? Well, that's because it doesn't exist. It was created out of a Tumblr meme based on a random combination of letters on the tag of bootleg merchandise. But Zoomers built a whole mythology around it just for fun. And that's what drives a lot of the nonsense this generation embraces. They just want something that lets them be silly. And that's let some people argue that it's not brain rot, it's just the new evolution in communication. Cultural anthropologist Mimi Ito coined the term genre of participation to refer to the media that encourages the audience to feel a part of it. That's part of the appeal many kids and teenagers find in the absurdity of brain rot. If they're focusing on singing toilets or fake movies or whatever scrolling on TikTok, they're not thinking about the climate crisis or dangers at school. Talking to many Gen Z students, scientists often find they consider brain rot to be part of their mental health support, but that doesn't mean it's safe long term. While some people are saying the kids are all right, the majority are deeply worried about the long-term impact of social media and brain rot on kids' brains as they come of age. That's led to some extreme proposals for solutions, the kind that might make the kids long for the cell phone bans. Florida was the first state to strike in the United States, with the Sunshine State passing a law that requires social media sites to ban all users under 14. This would cause the shutdown of countless accounts and force many kids to go cold turkey. But it'll be hard to enforce in the United States. The law puts the onus on the companies, and we all know kids are good at getting around bans, as any theater owner when the South Park movie was playing knows well. But that's nothing compared to what they have planned down under. Australia passed a total social media ban for all kids under 16. Far more dramatic, because virtually all 15-year-olds have social media and are in the middle of the period where they're most dependent on it. It's led to mass public outcry, with one millennial senator even taking to the floor to deliver a speech in Gen Z slang that shocked the rest of the body. It was certainly the only time skibbity was ever said in a parliamentary record. But other advocates are saying it's not the age of the users, it's how social media is used. Is it time for the tech companies to be held to account? Those defending the role social media plays in kids' lives say the problem is actually how they're fed content. They want the social media companies to do away with the endless scroll and the algorithm that feeds users an endless supply of content. And many users support that as well, which has led to the rise of Blue Sky, a Twitter-like site that proudly boasts of not having an algorithm and even allows users to hide trending topics. The future of social media could look very different, unless Mr. Beast buys it, of course. Have you noticed how endless scrolling or heavy screen time affects your focus, memory, or creativity? What's your strategy to fight brain rot? Drop your thoughts in the comments below. Looking for more information on how attention spans and other things have changed over the generations? Check out Every Generation Explained in 10 minutes, or watch this video instead.